Good afternoon. Welcome to the Art of Teaching Engineering Art Seminar Series. And before I forget, we need to thank Pentair Incorporated for their support for this series. Thank you very much, Lou. We hope to have a handful of these seminars. And we're doing this because today, perhaps more than ever, teaching faces many challenges. The teacher today has to do many other things besides teaching. They have to produce papers, and they have to produce dollars. And those pressures are making us rethink the art of teaching. And to open the series, I'd like to quote Hardy Cross, whom you must have heard of, who said precisely that teaching is an art. And asked a number of questions and made a number of statements that I would like to invite you to read because they are still pertinent today. He said, for example, that the teacher's job is to teach. He asked, what should the teacher teach? It sounds obvious, but it isn't. And I invite you to read the responses he wrote to his own questions because they are fascinating. He asked, for example, how much emphasis, how much importance should be placed on the curriculum? And I assure you, these answers are going to fascinate you. He also, of course, asked, how should a teacher teach? These are not obvious questions. And he asked a very tough question of, who is a great teacher? How can we tell who's a good teacher from the rest? He went as far as stating that the problem is one that doesn't have much to do with handsome buildings, or at his time, apparently, to project a slide wasn't easy, so he thought even that was too much of a luxury that wasn't essential. So with these questions, I'd like to introduce to you Professor Luis García. It's my great honor to introduce you, Professor García, and I want to thank you for making the trip all the way here to tell us about your experiences teaching. Frankly, I gotta apologize. Your resume is so long that I couldn't handle it, so I had to summarize it to a level where I can actually remember enough. So, for instance, Professor García has written two books. He has written two building codes. He has received fellowship or honorary membership from at least five international organizations. He has received awards from 10 international organizations. He's been in ACI Committee 318 for at least 30 years. And I don't mean to date you, but I find that fascinating. You've been teaching for at least 40 years also, as far as I can tell, and you've been designing for at least 40 years. And to, as if that wasn't enough, to top it all, he has designed 200 million square feet worth of construction.
Wow.
So, with you, Professor Luis García, thank you very much.
Thank you, Santiago. He was my student here, so he knows about that. And for me, it's an honor to be the first of this series of lectures. And in reality, teaching is a tool to get excellence in engineering, and in order for it to work, it has to be excellent teaching. And what we perceive as this has changed through times. So I want to go back, since we're addressing civil engineering, but the definition of civil engineering. The traditional one was the proper use of what nature has given us for the benefit of humanity. And now it looks selfish if we do that, because we change that definition about, it started to be changed about two decades ago, in which they include sustainability, so that we can do that without compromising the future of new generations and more things. So things will be added to this definition of civil engineering, which the focus is to use nature properly. And that addresses a lot of, or points out to a lot of issues very important with civil engineering, because in reality, there was military engineering first. And big examples of that will be seen, but we owe the change to civil to Napoleon, who was, in essence, he was an artillery officer. He devised ways to change what they were getting out of their artillery just before the French Revolution. He invented ways of concentrating the power of the type of shell they used at that time. But the most important thing was that he was a mathematician, because artillery had a lot of computation, and that made him somebody aware to things that he's known for his military success, but he was probably more successful writing laws. The Code Napoleon probably is one of the big additions to the judiciary system after probably what the Romans did. And he devised a code that is except to the countries that use common law, that's defined by the British. All of them at this point probably are using pieces or the whole of it of the Code Napoleon. Even in the US, Louisiana, it still runs using Code Napoleon. In a lot of things, it's the way it's addressed. I would say most of Latin America will be using Code Napoleon. Europe, France, of course, and a lot of countries use it. And Napoleon was the guy who changed the name of our profession, in the sense that we know of what engineering did with all the great cultures. And it was linked very close, but it was linked very close also to the military, until actually Napoleon came and he was instrumental in L'École Polytechnique was his funding. He gave a lot of support to Pont-et-Chaussée, still is the choice school in France for civil engineering. And he had the best people in engineering of his time working for him, Coulomb, and the people who he went with him to Egypt, Champollion, and a lot of people that mark, still mark, what the engineering way of doing things, civil engineering way of doing things. And if we stop for a brief moment, Rome, an empire that held at that point 90% of what the world was known in that moment, and they excel in bridges that still work. It's the Alcantara Bridge from Spain to Portugal. Roads, even we forget that the standard track was the distance between the two wheels in a Roman chariot at the time, and I was brought to the railroad with the same distance. They devised a way to handle water or drainage for the roads that still is being used. They brought water for kilometers. This is the Seville, Spain aqueduct, but you find that Rome survived it just because the way they were using the knowledge of hydraulics of the Romans wasn't that good, but they know about how much water they could get, about the slope, and a lot of other things. Buildings, for almost 2,000 years, it was the largest span built unreinforced on with mortar. The Romans knew how to change the self-weight of their concrete, to put it that way, so that they had this shell. Michelangelo studied it in depth before trying to attempt the St. Peter's Cathedral dome, and it's still there. But the same will be true for other things. The Colosseum, that was probably eight things. They took the rocks to build other things, and it had all the connotation that the Christians had been massacred them, which in essence is probably not true, because it was done afterwards and before the Colosseum stopped being used. But then, if we can jump, we must look at the big input to what we now know as civil engineering was done by the railroad. The railroad is the product of something that got the best of the engineers of the time. If you just look at the way the rail, standard rail that we use now, was developed, it's very good for fatigue. And it was done just by chance. They had something that couldn't go in a slope probably larger than 2%. They either, if they have a ravine or something like that, they will need to bridge. They will get into tunneling, and that brought a lot of challenges to the engineering that we know now. We still use things that came from the railroad, like the way to define the strength of materials. The idea at that time was that any material should be used only on the linear range, and that's still what we do. We define the quality of a steel by the yield point, and we, in essence, when they say 60,000 psi yield strength, they are saying don't go beyond 60,000 because the rest is of no use. It was of no use to the people of the railroad, but it was now we still define the quality of the steel by the end of the linear range. And that brought many other things like that. And the probably the other contribution came with the bridge building, in the sense that they, for the first time, went out of the arch. And the big battle was from going from iron to steel. The difference is common iron, you have 2% of carbon. If you go to steel, you have 0.2% of iron. And how to go from one or the other, you see all the movies, the hammering and a lot of techniques until Bessemer, who was German but made the invention here in the US, invented the converter, in which they, for the first time, could produce large amount of steel. And they got out of the loophole that the steel was for weapons only, and finally it came to be used for the railroad. In the first, let's say, civilian use of steel was pushed by the Industrial Revolution with the railroad. The railroad had another problem, so all locomotives, the two wheels turn at the same time. It meant that there was a lot of skidding, because in any curve, the outside wheel will go for a longer distance than the inside one, and the only one way was to slip. And that was the actual, a curve in an upgrade was the limit of what the locomotive could do, because they had one of the wheels skidding with respect to the other one, and at the same time they didn't want it to skid in the slope. So that was the limit, and that's the reason why you find in countries with large mountains they still have narrow gauge railroads, and the reason is that the narrow gauge railroad is more efficient, can go on a little larger slope, and could have almost less diameter in the curve that the standard railroad. That brought steel to other things. This is its bridge in St. Louis to cross the Mississippi, was the first large steel bridge made in the US, and it's arch, but it was the top of the line at the moment. And that was the French, this is designed by Eiffel, the same on the tower, and again, emulating the arch. But then came other types of bridges, the suspension bridges, initially the British, then the US. The important person, Roebling, he developed the type of steel wire needed to do the suspension bridges. And he, even though the disaster came afterwards, Tacoma, and he had been there. Because if you look at Brooklyn Bridge, you see that it's suspension with a combination of stays. And those stays came from the fact that he had had problems of lateral stability of the deck caused by wind blowing. And he had a failure. He put a bridge across the Niagara Falls for railroads. And it was so, it felt so unstable that they dismounted it, but Roebling came to the use of the stays because of the same problems that Tacoma had. And that's what, if we move to buildings, we have in mind for the question of these seminars is how, what's the important part of how we get to get excellent engineers? What should we do in the education of the young engineers with respect of the ultimate goal, which is good engineering? That's where the question lies. Hardy Cross, that Santiago quoted just a few minutes ago, said something very important about the building codes, because the teaching or not teaching of the building codes, why should we waste time in a classroom teaching something that the engineer will need to learn by itself afterwards? We should put our emphasis in principles, in things that for the engineering student will be more difficult to acquire without the benefit of being in a classroom. And Hardy Cross was very clear in saying that why do we need building codes, and we need them to keep at bay the rascals and the incompetent. And that's probably the best definition of a building code that we could have. There were other thoughts. Chet Sees, professor at the University of Illinois, he at a certain point came to the conclusion, by the time he was made president of ACI in 74, to say that we were wrong the way we were making the building codes too complicated, too complex, or both. And from that came movements to simplify the code. We have achieved something in that. ACI produces a document that started in Colombia, which is the now it's ACI 314. It's a simplified code. It has the principles of reinforced concrete in a way that you can build a safe up to 5-story building without using a computer. You don't need any computer to make analysis. It tells you what the order of magnitude of the forces are, gives you design procedures that will be safe for most cases, especially gravity. And on the other hand, gives the responsibility of lateral loads to shear walls that you will use depending on the how large is your earthquake demand or your wind demand. And that way, without having to have a computer, you can reach the dimensions and reinforcement of the building up to 5 stories. The limit is on a slab area per floor of less than 1,000 square meters. And with that, you document, you can use a hand calculator, and that's it. You need a computer to do so. Then came, in the engineering as we know, some biggest steps that came with the Industrial Revolution, but that changed the way we approach things. One was the we had better mathematical models. And from that came something that I, at the end, I think we need to reflect a little bit, is the way we are calling high school students to be engineers, to be admitted in schools like Purdue. And we are selecting them, or they are selecting themselves, because they think they have big mathematical skills. Do really want those guys? Because I remember when I was a student, I had always great faith on mathematicians. I couldn't care less about the proof of the theorem. What's the theorem good for? That's what I care. I'm an engineer. Let the mathematicians have their own disquisitions about if it's pure, the proof, and that. And if we choose engineers that can prove theorems, probably we are choosing the wrong people to do engineering. We want them to be practical. We want them to use the principles with wisdom, with a wisdom that's the key issue. How do they acquire that wisdom? Because no building have ever failed in a blackboard in a university. It had failed in the field. And that's the big question. How do we transmit wisdom or engineering judgment to the students, or teach them to acquire it? That will be our big question. The other part came late 1800s, most of the 20th century, and we're still in something that for me was a surprise. In my undergrad, Andes University had started as a sort of college for US universities. Some of the people from Andes came to Purdue. They did 3 years there, two here. The big chunk of this program was done with the University of Illinois. They graduated 700 undergrads with dual degree from the University of Illinois and this university. And since they were doing the last four semesters of their career undergrad students, the university was never really worried in engineering labs. They had labs for physics, chemistry, all the basics, but not for engineering. So for me, it was a big surprise when I arrived to the University of Illinois for my master's, and I found a different way of thinking. Either you prove it at the lab, or what you were doing, I'm talking mainly about reinforced concrete. Nothing has been invented in top of a desk in reinforced concrete. It had been always been proved, discovered, tuned, whatever, at the lab, never at the desk. And we have seen great errors in the way we design our reinforced concrete structures when the idea comes from somebody probably very intelligent, very well prepared, and they go without any testing because nature has the tendency to disprove engineers in reality. And if we go into earthquake engineering, we find that the real equalizer is the actual earthquake, that they always teach us something that we don't really know. The other thing was the impact of a computer. The computer in its beginning, for me, it's always funny how the Europeans call the computer. They call it ordenator, as if they resent that the computer is used for thinking, which was never the idea. But in the beginning, and I sort of lived it. We had two kind of computers, the digital that was more aimed at the business side, and the one that simulated that was used to solve differential equations. And this was the way the Russians went at the beginning, and in the US very early it was decided not to have this I don't know what the name in English is. This computer, they have resistance, analog computers, that big things to solve differential equations. They lost the battle very early in the game, and we moved to digital computing for the good, in my opinion, and that had a big impact in civil engineering, but I would say the largest impact in structures, because we were now able, even with small computers, to analyze structures we never had dreamed that we could do. Even though Cross, with the moment distribution method in the 1930s, made a big step for continuous structures, and with a lot of wisdom, he devises his method of moment distribution without really actually never solving sets of simultaneous equations. But the impact of the computer, we see it at the beginning as a computation machine, something that orders things in the mind of the Europeans, but in reality, it changed the way we design structures tremendously, because the time you go to papers written in 1950s, 60s, how much time would a structural designer spend designing a column? And now, when you look at it, 90% of the time was going to analysis, and they were using only about 10% of the time in designing the column, while now it's the other way around, and we can have as many analyses very fast without much physical effort, and we should spend our time designing. It's really our call, and leave the mathematical computation for the analysis to the machine. But we are probably not doing that. Then came the environmental awareness. And we engineers are very odd. We hated all the green guys. They came, don't use cement because it's bad. Don't do this. And we were the owners of the problem. In my time, it was called sanitary engineering. And now it's called environmental engineering. The names of the departments in the engineering, civil engineering departments throughout the states in the late 1960s, they changed their name from civil engineering to civil and environmental engineering. And from that came a byproduct, who are the environmental engineers, that basically are departing from what the traditional civil engineering in our mind that we have. But the civil engineering is a person who knows about topography or geomatics, as it's called now, knows about materials, knows about structures, knows about foundations, soils mechanics. If you look at the baggage, it's large. And one of them is environmental or sanitary, because it was water supply, water disposal. That was the big challenge. And from that now came the environment, and we were stopped by them, and the green people won the battle. And we still try not to accept that. We think that we are the owners and the people called to solve the problem. We are not. We are being led by other people in different things, but that's there. And we have complex building codes, of course. You look at the graph of with the number of pages of the ACI 318 code, from the 908 version with 9 pages to the current one with 600 pages. And we must have something wrong if those are the rules of design. I mean, and they are not applicable to all types of reinforced concrete structures. There must be something wrong in the way we are doing that. And then earthquake engineering, which is really the catastrophe theory, in which is the situation we don't want to have. But how good are we at it is a good question, because how to address the earthquake resistant design came from the studies of the defense against nuclear weapons. Just after the Second World War, there were a lot of tests, and for something that was totally new, and they found that this is like having two hurricanes in which one is goes to the place where the bomb starts, then it hits and goes out, two hurricanes, and at the same time one earthquake. And from that, the philosophy of accepting damage that was later put in the Neumann Bloom Corning 1961 book on how to design reinforced concrete for earthquake resistance came. Let's accept that there will be damage and we dissipate energy, good energy, without avoiding shear failures, avoiding bond failures, and that's basically the basis of what we are doing right now. And the big question is, did engineering, civil engineering education follow the same path in the sense that one very important question is, should we inform the student or should we form them in dealing with what we are teaching? That's a big question because it leads to the second one. Are we want them to have a trade, just like a carpenter? It's a trade. They are taught very little, but we want them to know more. They need a baggage of other knowledge to make them good into a career. Something in which is very important that we teach them how to learn by themselves. If they lose that quality, they are lost. Their knowledge will be like in a glass ball, no way for anything else to penetrate afterwards. If they don't know how to learn, and if we don't instigate the love for acquiring knowledge, we lost our time here at the university because we are producing people of a trade, and that trade will be stagnant in the knowledge because there's no way for new things to enter. And now we have the challenge of education, of communication. Everything is on the web. The perception is that it will be available for millennia, which is not true. Try to find the same web page with the same knowledge just 3 months later. It disappeared. but the student thinks that it will be always available, always in the right moment, and it will in it something that the university is best doing, which is giving judgment on what you need, the student needs to learn. And that's what we lose with this availability. The web, everybody, why do I have to go to class if I can get the same knowledge? I don't think it's information. Information that is very volatile. One day it's there, the other day it's not there. The judgment is by the people who put it there that are putting it for many other reasons than the making a good, having a good engineer. It's done probably because of business, because they are making money, because they read how many people hit the page and that's good. It could be bad in the sense that it's junk knowledge. And it will, the worst part is it will eventually disappear with time. So if that competes with the formal education we should be giving our students, we won the war long time ago. Only problem is not everybody is aware of that. The other thing, what's light and what is rigorous? Being rigorous is something that we learn usually, grade school, high school, don't add pears and apples. That's the way they teach it, probably at grade school. But we are reluctant to do it so at the university because it's as if we were interfering with the freedom of the student. But they need that advice, and that's where the excellence in education comes. It's in discriminating what should be taught, the principles, what to give the tools to survive new circumstances for the new engineer as they graduate, and instead of just telling them do this, do that, because that you can get in the internet without much problem. And the big question, how do we inspire engineering judgment, which is what saves us? And let me present a case in which I'm using this as a tool for you to ponder what could have we done to avoid what happened here? Because you will see from every point of view of engineering judgment, that this is a collection of stupid decisions and were done by an engineer, supposedly with a lot of experience. And with experience, I remember many years ago in which an engineer was being proved wrong, and he said, but I have 20 years of experience. And then somebody from the audience said, well, sir, you're confusing an experience of 1 year repeated 20 times. And that's probably what we are going to see here. What you see there is the rest, the debris of the sixth stage of a building that collapsed in the city of Medellin in Colombia 3 years ago. The mayor's office of Medellin contracted the University of Andes, where I teach, to do a study of the collapse. And then the Andes decided to retain Professor Mere Sosen, Anthony Fiorato, former president of ACI, and myself to do a peer review or their own investigation. And we were with Mete in the building, the part that survived, and at a certain point I told him, you hear the drilling? The drilling is to put the dynamite to tear down the rest of the building, which they eventually did. We walk out. But let me show you the very sad story, and then the question we must make ourselves is how this could have been avoided through education, excellent education in engineering, if it's avoidable. 9th of October 12th, 2013, the sixth stage of construction, because it was, even though we'll see it's a continuous structure, it was built in six stages, of that building collapse. When you go to the render by the architects, you see it's a 24-story building. We'll see the plan, but you have an 8-story, then increases until you reach the sixth stage, 24. It had, between a stage and a stage, it had columns that are common to both stages. How they did address the issue of building slabs to a already existing column and how to connect that, no information we were able to find in the design records. And when you see something about the computations done in design, you say, well, the guy never even felt the problem, because if he didn't address the safety issues properly, I mean, the other one of how to build it, they will not be, that was not the worry. In October 11, one day before the collapse, the column S3 showed signs of distress. And let me show you a closer one. And anybody who had seen a column fail in a lab, a concrete column fail in the lab, since that, my God, they had a compression failure. The column is failed. And with what did they, you look it from the inside of the picture on the right, even the shower pipe is in the column. It looks like it's not, but it's there. And there was, of course, a lot of deflection. These are the partitions of the neighborhood. And then a city officer came and ordered the building evacuated. Immediately, the owner of the construction company said, no way. Why? Because the guy who ordered the evacuation was a geologist. Say, how come a geologist come and say that my building is not right, and that the guy knew more structural engineering than all the other people involved? And so he brought the police and evacuated the building forcibly. Didn't wait for it, and in the meantime he saved some 160 people from being in the building when it collapsed the next night. And the story is that the owner of the construction company got so mad that called the mayor of Medellin, told him this is unfair, that this building has been evacuated by a geologist. And then the mayor bent, because the other guy was very important, a big shot in the city of Medellin, and they were ordering the guy to be fired when the secretary of the mayor knocked in the door, and so the story goes, and Santiago can prove this, and they say, we were not to be disturbed. Sir, just to let you know that the building collapsed. Oh, and they took the order to fire the poor guy and threw it away, and how can we help? That was the reaction. I'm not going to bother you, but there's an interview in TV that went to all the news of the structural designer saying, there's no problem. These are exaggerations. like when Mark Twain said, all those hearsay about my death are exaggerations. So it's exactly the same situation. So the building collapsed that night. And then how many people were killed? There were 8 workers. They were trying to put some steel plates on this welding. And there's an engineer, the building resident, workers, 2 engineers that were working overnight trying to hold the building. Even talking with the fire department chief, he said that they found them with their hands. They felt the building falling on them. And very sad. One of them tried to run. The other one was a building resident. He was studying journalism. He thought that it was the big news. So he went there to take pictures when the building fell. And the other one was just a security guard that was unlucky to be 2 meters inside the building that fell. He had been 2 meters in the other side. Probably he had survived. So it's 12 people in total that were killed, but it could have been 160 if they had left the residence there. The building is, you see the elevator cores. Each one corresponds to one of the stages. And if you, probably if I, each one belongs to, and this is the 22-story part. You take this radial axis and you have 2 columns there that are common to both stages. So how they were loaded as the other one was being built, we don't know. It's a tricky thing to do because you have to take into account some deflection or settlement at the foundation as you load the foundation. But then you have partial load, you start adding more load, and everything is starting not to fit. And you are sending loads in an unknown way, because what you should do is build a new one and then connect, supposedly allowing all the elastic deflections, and you don't know. So you have 2 girders that go around. And you have some radial girders, and all the columns are in the axis here. They're long, and they have a few walls just in the other direction at the two ends, probably in the mind of the engineer for earthquake resistance. The column that fell was S3, this one. And it's the one shown in the pictures. But the R3 to the side probably was subjected to similar loads. And let me be showing some idea of what the strength of the column dimensions and all that. The first question that they asked for the peer review was if the Colombian building code was, this is the 98 version, at the moment of the collapse, the 2010 version had already been enforced, but that was a question for Mete and Tony Fiorato, is the code wrong or not? And it's the reinforced concrete part was based in ACI 31895. This is the 98 issue. And basically, the decision by them was that the code was equivalent to what you will have here in the US. And one important thing is that the Colombian versions, since the version in 1984, had been more conservative than the ACI 318 for moderate seismic zones. Colombia has the two largest cities, Bogota with a population probably around 10 million, and Medellin with a population close probably to 4, very close to where the line between moderate and high seismic risk zones divide. So one change in all the probabilistic gimmicks that are used to assess the seismic risk, and this line could move. So we thought that it was good to have something that asked for more confinement, more transverse reinforcement in the moderate because of that reason. And that has been done consistently since the 1984 version of the Colombian code. And these are well documented and explained at large in several references. The way the Colombian code works, we don't use the A, B, C, D, E, F, the alphabet that the AC7 uses. We have just minimum energy dissipation that will be A and B in AC7. We have the moderate that will be equivalent to the C, and we have the special, which is equivalent to DEF in the AC7 way of naming things. In Medellin is in a moderate seismic zone, and for all practical matters, the structure would have to be designed with the moderate seismic requirements, and that was the rule. And basically, the question if we had a code that was either outdated or was not. No, the code was up to date to the best documents available, and all of them were based in US standards. Then the question, how do we address safety for what we saw there? And the format you all know is that the same as 318. We have a strength reduction factor. It basically is something to lessen the enthusiasm of the designer that everything will be as in a lab. So usually you put a factor less than one, and depending on how well known is the phenomena, you will reduce it more. Flexure, for example, in girders that we know, it fits what we know experimentally with what we do theoretically. It fits very well. That factor is 0.9. For the 95 version of 318, for shear, it's 0.85. in because we know less about shear or the correlation with the let's say theoretical values. So what we do is use a factor. Then from experimental tests, we have a nominal strength. And all that has to be larger than a required strength, which is the service loads multiplied by load factors. I'm getting out of time here. So let me show you what the S3 column does, and probably the best research done in columns, it was done at the University of Illinois by Professor Richard in the 1920s and 30s. There was a parallel investigation in Lehigh University, but basically what we have in still in the 318 code came from Richard tests. He tested columns of that size, and he from that derived a lot of the requirements, but the most important piece for our purposes is that Professor Richard reached the conclusion that the nominal actual strength of a column would be with that equation, and we have the nominal concrete strength. We multiply by 0.85. 0.85 came from tests done by him, in which they cast the column horizontally and vertically, and they found that there was a 15% difference because of the water cement ratio being higher in a column cast the regular way. So they did this horizontally and found the difference with a lot of tests. And this will be the gross area of the column, the area of a steel, vertical steel reinforcement, and the reinforcing steel yield strength. And that was the is the equation that we have in the code still. In 318.14, it has the same equation. This was done in 77 for a manual to teach concrete behavior to students. I think, Robert, you have this video. And our impression after seeing this is that every reinforced concrete student must be exposed to that video in which they show you the column failing in axial load in a movie. And if the guy who designed this building had seen that, probably he would have not have made the error, but you never know. And when you look at the failure and you look at the column fail the day before the collapse, immediately you see that it's a column fail in axial load. So this in 318.14 is now in chapter 9, but the in 11 is equation 10.2, and in the 318.95 is equation 10-2. And now the defending column. We have something that has a meter and a half length, 20 centimeters, 8 inches in width. And the phi factor for this case is 0.7. There were cylinders taken from the column that gives us 3,400 PSIs for the 28 days of the concrete use there. The drawing said it was 3,000, so it was above. Then we have 1,500 times 200, the gross area. The amount of reinforcement is 8 number 5 bars plus 10 number 4, and that gives you a little less than 1% vertical reinforcement. It's in the edge. Then we have the steel, it was tested from surviving elements, is a 60 KSI grade steel. And when you apply the equation by Richard, you come to the conclusion that the axial load failure is 7,100 kilonewtons. And if you apply all the factors that says you, please take it as 4,000 kilonewtons. That's it. What was the demand on this? That's failure strength without safety factor, failure strength with safety factors. Then we evaluated just by tributary load, the load. I'll go fast in this part. And actually, we reached that 7.3 kilonewtons per square meter of service dead load. That was even less than what the structural designer had in the design record. And the live load required, and with that, we go through all the procedures. They use a live load reduction gimmick. We applied that because the design record said so. And with that, we reach 7,200 kilonewtons for dead load, 1,200 kilonewtons for live load. So we apply safety scheme without factors, 8,400 kilonewtons. But then let's go to the required strength. You multiply, this is 95 creating code, by 1.4 your dead load, 1.7 your live load. You reach that the required strength for the column is 12,000.2 kilonewtons. Okay? Take, divide by 10 and you have tons. So it's roughly. So let's apply the safety rule. Phi factor times nominal strength must be larger than the required strength. We do that part. We reach 4,000 kilonewton, and we do the required strength, 12,000. It's not even larger, it's less than. The strength without safety factors and the dead load, it's basically the same. So what's the safety factor of the building? One. No wonder it collapsed. How can we avoid through education this? It's gross disregard for the code, everything. I have other black marks for sizing and all that. I think I can go column section should have been larger. How large? Those three in the right will have the appropriate size just for axial load. I'm not talking anything about moment in addition. It's just gravity. What else? Problems with exceeded the minimum dimension the code allows. The hoop bar diameter is 6 millimeters. That's a quarter of an inch. It's not even raw here in the US. And it's done in Colombia, but it's you cannot use it in real buildings. You can use it the last two stories of certain buildings in low seismic risk zones. And for the hoops, excuse me, Richard came out with the amount of spiral reinforcement for a spiral column. And from that, later for rectangular hoops, these equations were developed. They, again, were not complied by him, by the designer. Richard found the amount of spiral reinforcement just by equilibrium. He equated the yield strength of the bars of the spiral against the strength you could get out of the confined concrete. That's the reason for the K. And from that came an equation that had been in the code since the 1930s that tells you what's the volumetric reinforcement you need to put in a spiral column for it to be granted a lower phi factor when you use it. So, I'm sorry I will jump on this because the situation is that all the confinement, if the earthquake, if an earthquake had hit, even a mild one, the building, since the moment they finish construction and people move in, to the moment of the collapse, with the very little horizontal acceleration, it would have gone. And they were looking for that excuse. We had to screen all the records from the network and the equivalent of the USGS, the Colombian network, to find if there had been any kind of earthquake close by. Nothing. So I like to finish with a...
Dear Dr. García, first, let me thank you for asking my opinion about the root cause of the collapse of Edificio Spouse in Medellin. I have studied your analysis of column S3, and I agree with you completely. It is very unfortunate that mistakes have been made in proportioning the columns. They are too small. Considering the demand due to self-weight alone to be 723 tons, and the resistance based on the dimensions of the column as built and the strength of the concrete and the steel being 726 tons, I think they're too close to one another for the building to survive for any length of time. In view of the fact that there had to be some applied load on the structure, it was a miracle that the structure lasted as long as it did in its built condition. I do understand that the strength, the actual strength, could have been a few percentage points higher, and the load on the column may have been a few percentage points lower. But even then, the proximity of the demand to the resistance suggests, indicates, confirms that the column is going to fail within a finite period of time. In my opinion, the provided evidence points to the fact that the disaster was due to errors in sizing the columns. I'm very sorry that such a tragedy had to take place. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor García. Any questions for Professor García?
Now the question we should ask ourselves is, how can we prevent in the education of our engineers for things like this not to happen? Because I'm sure the guy knew that the code said so, but he thought that he knew more. He never really realized the implications of just saying, no, I know more. This code is an exaggeration, as I think his brother that teaches at the university in Medellin keeps on claiming and disturbing the minds of his students. So one, but on the other hand, should we tell our students that everything is in the code, which I myself think is an error, because that will, he will learn the code probably afterwards and has to abide by it, that's the law. But do we teach wisdom to our students just by telling them the code? But the code demands explanation in the way we teach. And we should tell where things came from so that the student acquires his own judgment on things. I think that...
I do have a question, and Lindsay responded. Here's one.
Very interesting. I didn't understand it as a lack of teaching for this guy, but complete negligence. Because what I understood. understood that there is no safety factor. So do you agree with this, or maybe I'm missing something in the story?
We always wonder, how could have made him that such a gross error and not being aware of it? And when you go to the record of what really happened there, like 3 months later, in one of the lower buildings, they had a similar failure of the column. And I talked with the foreman of the group that fixed it. And I asked him, did you see the bars buckle? I didn't use the pandeo or buckling is in the job site or something. They think that, I say, you saw the bars like this, vertical bars. I say, yes. So he had already had, and this stage was under construction at that point. So, I mean, it's very sad. This is what shouldn't have happened. Poor 8 people that got killed because of gross negligence. And he, the worst part is seeing him in a TV interview just the day, the evening of the day of the collapse, saying there is no risk at all. It's exaggerations. So, yeah, I agree with you that. But I had a question of something that was here that we should think about that. But I want to point out that we should avoid what I call F5 engineering. F5? Bingo. That's what we are seeing now. And I asked the young engineers in my office, say, they have a SAF 2000 thing there, and I ask them, red is bad or good? They don't know. that's what we should avoid. And probably the guy what did was that, F5, with the wrong program. Thank you very much.